day last time. What I'd like to talk about is one project that me and some of my collaborators are working on. The broad theme is about climate change. On climate change, with one of my co-authors, we have published a book on climate change that was published in 2013 by Oxford University Press, which had a kind introduction from Robert Kerr, who's a Nobel Prize winner in chemistry. So I had written a book earlier on pension reform 8 years ago, which was also prefaced by another Nobel Prize winner, Robert Fogel in economics. So I have the honor of having two of my books with introduction by two Nobel Prize winners in two different disciplines. I'm working on my third one. Hopefully I'll get a third Nobel Prize winner to have. And in fact, we'll write a book on this stuff. And all these books are written by different co-authors. The trick to do research, as I see it, is if you're not smart, you know, like I'm not smart, but I do get other smart people to write stuff with me. So that's the trick. If you can get both of smart people to work with you, you have it made. We have this paper, or a version of this paper, a newer version of this paper, under review and release submit in one of the big journals. So hopefully we'll have it published by the end of the year. The only challenge is that our original paper was about 13 pages long, and the editors want it down to less than 2 pages. So that's our challenge. So we asked for, okay, can we submit supplementary material, because we have a supplementary material of 125 pages. They said that has to be cut down to 60 pages as well. So we shall see. With that introduction, let me just, before I get into the nitty-gritty of the things, some of the stuff I have, let me just mention that what exactly do we, why are we doing this study? So, basically you have a whole bunch of climate scientists, most of them are coming from different disciplines, and what they are arguing about is that, number one, that's fact number one, is that greenhouse gases globally are increasing. So what you sometimes do hear about is CO2e, which means carbon dioxide equivalent. So you have a whole bunch of greenhouse gases, they are all they're all classed as greenhouse gases. So it's not just carbon dioxide, you have methane, chlorofluorocarbon, a whole bunch of other stuff. And what they would argue is that, number one, the greenhouse gases are increasing. Number two, therefore, the temperature will rise. Now, to claim that, you need scientific evidence that greenhouse gases are actually causing a rise in temperature. Okay, broadly, we do know, you know, from lab experiments that there are effects, but when you do it in the lab, it's a very different situation than what happens out there on the field. So what exactly is the evidence that they cite? So typically they will cite something like this. So what you have here is time, and this is from the 1990 IPCC report, the first one, and they said, okay, here we see the carbon dioxide, and they have other things too, like methane and so on. The point they try to make is that if you look at the time series of carbon dioxide, and if you look at the local temperature change, you see when these have peaks, so do these. And therefore, so this is the big jump, and therefore there is a cause and effect relationship. So that's the standard argument. There are a couple of things to be said here. Number one, measuring carbon dioxide from the past.
Yeah, how did they estimate 1,000 years before? How did they estimate?
Okay, so the basic data that comes from the standard one, we have actually different time scales. We have in our study, we look at 20,000 year time frame, we look at 800,000 year time frame, and we look at 325 million year time frame. Okay, so they all use different methodology for estimating various things. So to start with carbon dioxide, for example, for the 800,000 year data, they have data from what they call the ice core data. So they drill a hole in, they're still drilling a hole in Antarctica. And what they do is, as they go down, they estimate the age of that layer. And there are bubbles of air trapped in there from that period. So they actually physically calculate that stuff. So that's how the carbon dioxide estimated. Of course, when you estimate these things, they're never exactly one single number. So you get a band, and that's why you see these thick lines. They are not time series in your regular sense of the word. You do not have one observation at one point in time. You have a band, you have a confidence band, basically. Similarly, the temperature, these are also bands, they estimate the temperature at that point in time in the past through some other indirect method. So they are not, obviously, direct observation of temperature at that time, but they look at other chemical stuff to estimate that stuff. Again, since these are estimates, so they are time intervals, never a single point.
These data are put up at public domain?
Oh yeah. If you go to the NOAA website, they're all there. I don't have the reference here. This one was the first report. So this one goes only back to 160,000 years. They kept on drilling, and then they went 400,000 years, and now they're up to 800,000 years. And in about another 200,000 years, meaning another 200,000 years down, they will hit a lake. We know that. So that would be the end of the data. But it is not just, you know, drilling a hole, because when they drill a hole, each time the things get brittle, and if it breaks, they have to start all over again. But then they have to perforate the hole at a different spot. And then they have to re-estimate everything, because that spot may not be the same as that spot because of continental drifts and all that sort of stuff. So it's not as easy as it sounds. These are multi-million dollar projects where Russians are involved, Swedes are involved, Americans are involved. They are all doing, they started with different holes. You know, each country started with their own hole, and then they decided this is ridiculous. We are doing all the same thing. So they all put together, now they are doing a single hole so that all the data come from the same source. Now there's agreed upon method that this is the right way to do things. That itself was not clear for the first 10 years, yes.
So is the percentage of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere,
yeah,
is homogeneous across the globe?
Given a time diffusion period of about 100 years, yes. So it may not be the same today versus 5 years from now, but if you let the equilibrium space go, then in 100 years they will be. Okay?
And yesterday was maybe in some figure, let's say, that might be considered it was 200 million or something.
Yes.
Antarctica was 150, might be.
And that big of a difference would not exist. So they will, within 100 years, they will be within a few ppms. Yeah, so then there will be 5 or max 10.
Okay.
So it's not exactly the same, but it's pretty close. It's like our body temperature. You know, if you look at the body temperature at the fingertip and inside my stomach, the difference is 0.1 degrees Celsius. It's a pretty amazing thing when you think about, you know, in a refrigerator, to get a 5 degree difference between extreme within the refrigerator is a very big task. So our bodies are very, very finely tuned, and similarly for the atmosphere. As I mentioned, mentioned earlier that they went back, you know, they kept on drilling. So this was the next step, 400,000 years. And again, same pattern emerges. That you have one time series where you can look at the temperature deviation from what they call the norm, and CO2 concentration. Again, you know, roughly speaking, visually, peaks here or coincide with the peaks there. But they're not exact. If I superimpose one on the other, as you can see, they're not exactly coincident. Okay, they're similar, but they're not exactly coincident. So that's as far as you can go with this kind of data. Why is that? The reason is that when you dig a hole and you start measuring the thing, you don't know, you don't have like financial data, everyday observations. You get whatever you got. So you can say, okay, this happened 50,022 years ago, and the next observation may be 50,088 years ago. And for the other stuff, you do not have the same date. That's our starting point.
How is the temperature measured?
With some chemical signature. So there are different methods of measuring.
One measurement
is
ESM,
that is
for electron
spin
resonance.
Yes. So this gentleman knows all about that. There are other methods of measuring the temperature and the carbon dioxide. For example, if you go to a scale of 350 million that I was talking about, then you no longer have this sort of luxury of trapped carbon dioxide that time. Because to start with, the continents were at a different space. But what you can do is look at the fossilized leaves of trees from that time that are trapped in various parts of the world. And you look at the concentration of chlorophyll in the leaves. From that, you can estimate how much carbon dioxide was there in the air. So we have that scale data as well. And our aim is basically to do two things. One is to having these unequal time series to convert them into an equally spaced time series. And that kind of stuff can be very useful in financial work, where some kinds of data you do not have equally spaced time series. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. So the problems that arises when you have unequally spaced time series, very simple. So, all the time we talk about correlation. Okay, so what does correlation measure? It's a linear association between two variables, very simple. And then you can, you know, talk about Pearson correlation, rank correlation, and stuff like that. So if you think about correlation, it's the first approximation of the association, because the association can be non-linear. And we know these kinds of things, the relations can be very non-linear. Why? Because there are feedback effects. So carbon dioxide, higher carbon dioxide leads to high temperature, which leads to more carbon dioxide, and so on and so forth. So these feedback problems can make life difficult. So to calculate correlation, we need observation at the same time intervals. And the second problem that always arises in any kind of statistical problem is that if you have two things correlated, that does not necessarily mean one causes the other. And you see these kinds of things all the time in you know, reports of such and such thing causes cancer or things of that nature. Just because they are correlated, that does not mean anything at all. The most famous one is probably was done by Ronald Fisher in the 1920s, where he argued that there are two things, there is one factor that absolutely completely correlated with the number of people admitted in London hospitals. One variable he found, and he shows in great detail, and last line of the paper, it says, that variable is coconut production in the Caribbean. Obviously, he was trying to prove that correlation does not mean causation. And that's one thing that you have to be careful about. You have to have a story as to why, rather than just blindly calculating correlation and hoping that, well, the correlation is high, therefore, no. You have to have a plausible story that tells us why the relation holds. So, let me give you some gory details of the model that actually we use. So we start off with a stochastic process, and we have actually of this process, we do not observe the process itself. All we observe is a sample path, just one set of observations. That's it. That's all you got frozen in time. So you have a sample path which is observed at different time spans. So the important point here is that the distance between T1 and T2, T2 to T3, etc., are not equally spaced. Financial time series, or most of the economic time series that we typically analyze, are not of this kind. They usually, for a variety of reasons, are observed at same time. It arises in other forms where they are not. For example, you have frequency of stock market data every day, every second, etc. But if you say, okay, I want to relate that to GDP, then you're stuck, because GDP only comes at most once in 3 months in advanced countries, once a year in most other countries. So what you do, typically you say, okay, I can push it further by saying that is related to, say, industrial production in a country, which I have every month. So the best you can do is month-end data for industrial production and month-end data for stock market. And as we saw just a few moments ago, that the stock market data do not behave the same way if you change the scale of your observation. So this is our basic process. We assume that XT follows a Gaussian process with a constant mean and some covariance function. So here, this is a vector, and the mu is a vector, and sigma is a covariance matrix. So by assuming a constant marginal variance for each XT, we can express the covariance function. Then it simplifies a bit if we assume a constant marginal variance. And this isotropic correlation function behaves like a survival function, and this is where what our first contribution is to identify this stuff as a survival function. Survival function is something very common in actuarial science, but it's not at all used in, we didn't see some survival function stuff just a moment ago, so, but not as much. And so here, if we have two parameters of this stuff, then we can write it in a somewhat simplified form. And again, if you take the survival function in that form, then this is log-logistic and so on. So some tractable forms are necessary. Some simplification necessary in order to proceed further. And what we do is, in the previous version that I showed in the earlier page, you only have only positive correlation, but in these cases we want to admit positive and negative correlation, so we add a little bit of stuff to that. And so essentially, we have a product of two positive semi-definite matrices. The first factor is a monotonically decreasing positive function. The second factor defines a variance covariance matrix for any set of endpoints. It's also a positive semi-definite. And the first eigenvalue being n and rest of it zero. So the product of those two produces a well-defined model. Now what we want to do is to apply some Bayesian method for estimating all this stuff. Why are we going Bayesian? Why don't we do classical standard analysis? We could. But we do have Bayesian methods which allow us to do these kinds of estimation via Monte Carlo, and that turns out to be a very tractable way to give you these kinds of problems. So you write down the joint distribution with some parameters we're going to estimate. We go from prior to posterior, very standard Bayesian method. So what's the whole point of doing all of these things? Remember, basically what we want to do is we have observations which are at different points in time that are not necessarily equispaced. And what we want to do is to have everything equispaced. So that's the goal of this thing. So essentially what you want to do is the easiest part, most obvious way to deal with that is to say, okay, if I have between this stuff, this point is here, so I just interpolate between these two points. So at the crudest level, what we are doing is a sophisticated version of interpolation. Okay? But of course, you know, we are not saying, okay, take the weighted average of these two and that's the interpolated value. No. What we are doing is taking the entire distribution and from that, generating each observation. So because we are using the entire distribution to generate that value, we are not going to get a point estimate, we are going to get a distribution. So each point here will actually be a distribution. Okay? So that's why computationally this method is rather laborious. So basically when we do the runs, you know, you start the thing, go away, have a cup of tea, come back, it's still running, have dinner, it's still running. Hopefully the next day it will converge and produce some results. Or if it explodes, we know that there's something wrong with the code. It's start all over again. So it's a laborious process, but not extraordinarily a smart thing to do. As I said, I'm not very smart. Okay. So essentially, what we do is we need to have some priors of these things. New process, we use a normal. The other things, the sigma squared is inverse gamma, lambda is another gamma, alpha is uniform, and beta minus 1 is a Bernoulli distribution. Where do these things come from? Well, these are things, the prior generator is, you know, it's, they say generating prior, the process of generating prior is like making sausages. You do not want to see how it's done. You only want to see the end product that comes on your plate and then you eat it. The same thing we can say, the generating this stuff is like making samosas. You do not want to see how it's actually made. I was in Kolkata just last week, and we live very close to the South City Mall, and in one of those big fancy restaurants, they actually outsource making of some of the fish fries to one of the catering company, which is right next to where we live. So often they come into our alleyway where they actually make the fish fries, they prepare the fish fries, and they do the frying actually in the mall. But the rest of the stuff is done in our alleyway. I know how dirty that place is. And of course they give us free samples and so on. But So when you eat in a fancy mall, keep that in mind. It's not made in a very hygienic spot. So these are my unhygienic components of the model. My co-author will be very unhappy that I say something because he does all of this stuff. So the posterior, you have a pad and then you do the posterior.
If you change them, are they as unhygienic? If you change those, is it as unhygienic?
There is no hygienic way of doing this. That's what I get to know. That's right. So the posterior looks some ugly expressions, but you can actually generate the mu given the rest. It doesn't look too bad. And the posterior of the sigma square turns out to be inverse gamma. The reason why we use those kinds of priors is because that generates these sorts of nice solutions, if you like. And the posterior conditional distribution for beta minus 1 turns out to be another Bernoulli with some parameters. Again, these are tedious algebra you have to go through in order to prove these things, but they are not really all that complicated in terms of concepts. So this is, as I said, these are fairly standard kind of posterior estimation of the Bayesian kind. Therefore, the posterior distribution will be obtained by usual standard Gibbs sampler, and sampling from those conditionals is fairly straightforward in the standard form. And of course, you need some sort of metropolitan Hastings kind of methods to actually generate the numbers. So we do all that. We do the stability test. We do the robustness check and all that good stuff, and they turn out to be fairly simple. The only thing that happens is that when you try to estimate the lambda and alpha, you end up with a very quickly rising at the rate of n to the power of 3. These matrices just explode. So what you want to do is you want to take a subsample of these things so that you can end up with, you know, you are not inverting any matrix more than 500 by 500. Of course, these are mostly sparse matrices, so 500 by 500 is not that bad. And that's what takes time, the inverting these matrices. But then you try to, use the training method in order to estimate these things so that the estimates that you get are fairly stable. They're not always 100% stable, but most of the time they are. So that's what we do. And this Bayesian method of interpolation, as I mentioned earlier, that essentially what we are doing is interpolation. And this sort of method has actually been used, but not in time series literature at all. They have been used in the spatial literature, where you have observation, various observations in space. So you have some observation here, you have another observation at this point. So imagine this is Calcutta, this is Chennai. You have observations there, and you want to interpolate the values in between. So that's what I mean by spatial observations. So these kinds of things, this is what is called Kriging methods. So Kriging is fairly common in the spatial literature. So for example, if you want to know the rainfall between two points where you actually measure, you want to know what happened in between. You do not have any observation. What do? Well, basically use this Kriging method. So what we have done is to use the Kriging method with the Bayesian twist for time series cases. So that's essentially what we have done. And that's our contribution to this literature.
One question.
Yeah.
What was necessary? Without that, the Bayesian thing would not be correct.
Without
Kriging, I wouldn't be able to do it. Which do I need equal times BC for doing these Bayesian studies?
You could do it by classical methods too. Okay. But since my co-author is Bayesian. Yes. That can be done. So Bayesian method as such is not essential, but it makes life easier in terms of actual estimation, because you can do the prior to posterior thing using Gibbs sampler and do the whole thing. Alright, so what do we get? After all of this, what is the end result? So this is the end result. This one is the temperature as original, and this is the equispace. So if you look at them, you cannot tell the difference. So, and actually we do statistical tests to prove that they are not different. So essentially we can regenerate the whole process with the now we have equal space. But remember, each point was not a point. Each point was a distribution. What I'm showing you here is the midpoint value. Okay, so this is the average of that distribution. Alright, so they're not necessarily symmetrical, they're not Gaussian, obviously they're complicated beasts, but their average value, actually their medians, are very, very similar. So what we have done is successfully transited from the unequally spaced to equally spaced.
So computationally, how long does it take for you, for example, if you have a time series data of that length, to get this one, how much computation do you need?
We don't have very sophisticated computers. You know, standard garden variety 64-bit computer takes about 6 to 8 hours, depending on how dense your data is and how you want to sample. Remember, I'm taking a sample of 500, so if you say I'm not happy with the 500, I want 1,000 by 1,000, then it will be much, much more complicated. Not complicated, I mean time-consuming. So that's all. This one, if you have sufficient computing power, I'd say in a couple of hours it would be able to do it without any problem. Same thing we do with CO2. Again, this is the original data, this is the equispace data, as you can see. And again, we do a whole series of statistical tests to show that they are very, very close. Once you have this equispace time series, you can apply methods of regular economic and financial time series. So, as I said earlier, that we have a 30,000 year time frame data, we have 800,000 time frame data, and we have 350 million time scale data. And why is that important? Because what we want to do is to make sure that whatever results we get is robust, in the sense that atmospheric conditions change, the form of the surface of the Earth change, but the relationship, whatever we are trying to discover, still holds. And therefore, we want to know this happening over different time scales. So if we have a set of results that are invariant to time scale, close thereof, then we are very confident that whatever happens within the next 100 years, you know, the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere is expected to go up from about 400 ppm to, depending on how we react, as Professor Chakravarti said earlier, that you know, interacting humans are not invariant like physical particles. So we can react to whatever is happening out there. So if we react to that, maybe we'll stabilize it at 500 ppm, and that will be that. Or maybe we'll not learn the lesson, we'll go 1000 ppm. I don't know. But the point is that we want to know how much that change is going to change the temperature bit. Obviously, we are not going to get a point estimate, we are going to get an interval estimate. It's always an interval estimate, but that's not the important thing. The important thing is to get a better handle of this cause and effect business. And the second thing, you know, when you look at these kinds of time series, one thing you realize is that they are not, if you look at a shorter time scale, so for example, if you start at 1950 and look at 2015 data, annual data, monthly data, whatever you, the monthly data actually have some variation up and down, but annual data pretty much I guess stable or goes up. So if you look at a short time scale, say 50, 60, 100 year time scale, you will see that the properties of these time series are non-stationary. Whereas if you look at these grander scales, no longer so. And they go up and down, but they have stationary properties. So once you have stationary time series, you can actually ask the question of causality in the sense of Clyde Granger. Clyde Granger analyzed these kinds of stuff, and essentially his take on causality is that if something happens at time t in series x and that affects at time t plus 1 in series y, and consistently so, then we have causality. So causality in the sense of correlation, but between time t at one time series and time t plus 1 at the other time series. So as I was mentioning that, you know, the whole entire Earth, this is Pangaea, the supercontinent that we used to have 350 million years ago. And they all drifted apart. So here is Eurasia, North America, Africa, South America, Antarctica, Australia, and India. India was very close to Australia, we were neighbors, and then we drifted apart. And then India went back to China, and that's how Himalayas were formed. If you go up 8,000 feet high in the Himalayas, you can still see the fossils of fish and stuff like that. In fact, Benghazi, Chennai, and Perth were neighbors. So as I mentioned earlier, what we want to do is to measure the correlation not at the same point in time, but at x at t and y at t minus t plus 1. Obviously, you can generalize that y stop at t plus 1. I can relate that, correlate that to xt to t, yt plus 1, t plus 2, etc. And that's what the Granger causality is all about. So basically, you take a vector autoregressive model, and then you estimate the parameters. The nice thing about this is now we have lots of observations. I say observations within quotes because these are not actual observations. They are estimated from a model. So they are somewhat synthetic observations, if you like. But we do have now a whole lot of observations which you typically do not get in economic time series. You get annual data, maybe 100 years, and so if you have 5 or 6 vector autoregressive vectors and you have 100 years data for each of those, you know, if you take a lag of 10 years, you've already run out of parameters to estimate. You know, you don't have enough observations to estimate the parameters. Here, on the other hand, we have a lot more observations in that sense. So, what we are doing right now is we are in the process of another kind of samosa making, where we are actually trying to estimate these vector autoregressions with various kinds of specifications to see what works, what doesn't work, what is stable, what is not stable, and so on and so forth. So as I mentioned earlier, that normally people talk about just CO2, but really these are there are just a whole bunch of other things like methane and nitrous oxide, nitric oxide, so that NO2X then could be NO2, NO3, the CFC and other stuff. So now they have reconstructed this series not just for CO2, but also this other stuff. So we actually have different variables to run these vector or regressive model. And so essentially these are simultaneous equivalent methods for doing this stuff. And that's the stage we are at. We are in the process of doing all of these things. So as I mentioned earlier, what is the relevance of this in the financial time series? So obviously, typically you get equispaced data for accounting reasons. So every year the government collects data for calculating GDP and other stuff for other purposes. So that's how we get, you know, end of the financial year data and so on and so forth. But they are collected for something else. For the high frequency data, it could be different because your trade of this stock may not coincide with the trade of the other stock. So what do? You can do other methods, as he mentioned, that there are other methodologies for dealing with that sort of stuff. But this is one method that can be used. So actually, we do have applied for a patent for our method for applying financial time series, and it's in the process of, I don't know whether we get a patent or not. If we do, we'll be millionaires. Otherwise, I'll come back next year to do another talk. Thank you. Now, 450 years later, that stuff will dissipate. But it will be 450 years. So if the humanity lives that long, then we could survive the next cycle. But the question is whether we would or not. So for example, you know, if you take the extreme case, if the concentration goes to 1000 ppm, then the sea level will rise 30 feet. 30 feet is a lot of water.
Present price is only 20 centimeters.
Sorry?
Present price is 0.2 centimeters.
Yes, right now it's like that, but if it goes to 1000 ppm,
yeah,
then it will go because of this feedback loop.
Up to 20, 30 projected sea level is 0.5.
But we still don't know. There's a lot of uncertainty involved. There's a model uncertainty in this whole business as well. And that complicates the matter. Really, really don't know the tails, the behavior of the tails of these distributions. Yeah.
Will this be of, will be accessible to us in terms of, since you said you put it up for patent application?
Uh-huh.
I mean, this paper.
Oh, the first paper is available. You know, if you Google, you'd find it. But we have not made the code public. For that reason. So that's the part we have. Well, actually, the code itself you cannot patent, but the application you can patent. So our thing is that we are going to apply this to financial methods.
This Gaussian random field, does it, are you anything about the path like financial?
Yeah, they are all nice ones. I mean, there's no jump process and things like that. No. These are very nice distributions.
Because otherwise it will become untractable very, very quickly.
So the Brownian motion would not be a infinite relation would not be a Gaussian relation.
The what?
The Brownian motion which is infinite relation, would that also be a Gaussian?
We are not working in continuous time, we are working in discrete time. So all of this is in a discrete time.
Yeah, but can you write your distributions that this survival function is time scalar?
Yes, yes.
So you do have continuous time?
Yes, underlying all of it is, it is continuous, yes.
So did you done with this causal effect, causal effect part? That was you did the article here.
Did?
Causal effect that is done?
We are in the process of doing it. Preliminary results suggest that there is. For certain time scale, there is causality going one way, that is CO2 is producing higher temperature. Actually, we have an estimate of how much would, say, if it doubles, how much would the temperature rise? It would rise about 4 degrees, that's our estimate. But at certain other time scale, it's bidirectional causality. And that probably happens because you know, in the past, there had been, if, for example, right now, if the temperature rises to a certain level in the Arctic region, there's a lot of methane trapped there, that will get released. So higher temperature will cause a rise in value of methane in the air. So cause and effect will go both ways, and that's the feedback effect I was talking about.
Actually, CO2 is adjusted in any of the fossil fuels combustion.
Yes.
But there are some natural mechanisms like this, all this.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
But
I mean,
other particles are emitted with CO2, mm-hmm. they are not absorbed by natural like nitrous, so nitrogen compound, sulfur compound, and the rest of the chemicals like ammonia and methane and ammonia and the particle is also here.
Nitrous oxide does come back, you know, with the rain and stuff, acid rain and so on. Yes, we are not, you know, we are not talking about necessarily is this caused by human or not. That's not our question. Our question is simply, how does CO2 affect the temperature and or vice versa, for natural or otherwise?
That is a government that was free energy, and probably the problem of the universe is increasing. And the problem is that the government has all these problems, and probably the product is very well dependent on the natural. That is natural. We are observing how it affects the climate.
Yep. Okay, thank you very much.